Hi, everyone, and welcome to another series of Foundry virtual events. My name is Joyce, your marketing host for today. I'm here today with my colleague, Chris Andriarta, Associate Product Manager here at Foundry. And of course, our main guest for today, Tony Lyons, Senior Compositor at Trickster in Germany. Before we dive into Tony's session, I just wanted to share a couple of updates with you guys. So we have over 37 webinars on demand available on Livestorm. For more information on where you can find them, you can go onto our events page, foundry.com/events. If you have any questions, you want to share any feedback, or you want to participate in our virtual events, please send us an email on virtual.events@foundry.com. We've got a couple of, quite a few webinars coming up in the next few weeks or so. The first one coming up already next Tuesday, how to progress your career with your local VFX community in India. That will be at 6:30 p.m. Indian Standard Time. This is a partnership with London ACM SIGGRAPH as well. We also have a Katana webinar coming up on November the 5th. We also have a French Katana webinar happening on November the 10th. And on November the 12th, we have a Nuke and Episodic Animation Skill Up as well. So for more information on how you can register, you can check our events page. We have loads of content available on our Foundry Learns page. We've got documentation, release notes, dev docs, and loads more. You can find all of this on our learn.foundry.com page. We also have some cool material with Austin Myers, a freelance VFX supervisor who we currently collaborated with. He's put together some fantastic new tutorials, videos together for us. So you can find those on our Learning Hub as well. So for more information on those, you can check our events page. But this is definitely some very useful videos. So do definitely check them out when you have some time. Stay up to date with us, follow us on our social media channels, and of course our Insights Hub as well, where we have plenty of case studies and artist spotlights and more articles. So definitely check those out as well when you have some time. So as you know, the Emmys are happening today. If you are interested in watching the live stream, you can do so by visiting the Emmys page and going to the events section. You will find a registration link there. And I will also make sure to drop this link in the chat chat tab in a second. And for your information as well, it is at 5 p.m. Pacific time, which is, I believe, 12 a.m. here in the UK, if I've done the right time zone conversion, and 1 a.m. in Central Europe as well for any early birds who would like to attend. Lastly, a massive thank you from all of us to all the studios and all the artists and freelance artists as well who have participated with us and at Foundry Virtual Events. And thank you for sharing your stories. Thank you for sharing your experiences. And we are looking forward to building up this with many more studios and many more artists as well in the coming year. So thank you again to all of you guys. And that's it for me. Thank you again for joining. And I'm going to hand over to Chris, who's going to be talking a little bit more about Nuke Indie. Thank you. Over to you, Chris.
Thanks, Joyce. So for those of you who didn't see the announcement, with the release of 12.2 v3, we made some changes to Nuke Indie based on feedback and comments from the community. We've added support for H.264 video and AAC audio into Nuke Indie, bringing it in line with commercial Nuke Studio, as well as enabling support for third-party OFX nodes. This allows you to run popular plugins such as Boris FX's Mocha Pro and ABSoft's Neat Video. We are actively working with developers of popular commercial NDK-based plugins towards enabling them in the near future for support in Indie. Just while I've got you here, we do have a Q&A part of the show, which if you've got any questions that you'd like to ask me or Tony, if you can use the questions tab over, I think it's that side. Yeah, we'll be getting through those towards the end of the show, and we'll try and get through as many of those as we can. Okay, so without further ado, let me introduce Tony.
Hi, everybody. I'm Tony Lyons, senior compositor at Trickster Studios in Munich, Germany. I'm originally from the USA, and I've traveled around a bit and have over 10 years of compositing experience. Some of you might know me from my green screen keying tutorials on my Compositing Mentor website and YouTube channel. I'm also the curator of the Nuke Survival Toolkit that we're going to be going over. So yeah, happy to be here. Thanks, guys. Hello everyone, and welcome to this webinar. I'm Tony Lyons, and I'm going to be showing you the Nuke Survival Toolkit. And the first thing we're going to do is show you an introduction video for those of you who don't know what the Nuke Survival Toolkit is. And after that, we'll jump into some of the tools that are located in the Nuke Survival Toolkit, and we'll be seeing how they can help you overcome some of the challenges that we face every day in compositing. So without further ado, here is the introduction video. Hi, I'm Tony Lyons, and in this video, I'm going to be giving a brief introduction to the Nuke Survival Toolkit. The Nuke Survival Toolkit is a portable tool menu for the Foundry's Nuke with a hand-picked selection of Nuke gizmos collected from all over the web, organized into one easy-to-install toolbar. Along with having hundreds of tools from some of the best Nuke artists in the world at your fingertips, the Nuke Survival Toolkit also seeks to answer three important questions. Where does the gizmo come from? Who made the gizmo? And what does the gizmo do? To try to answer these questions, the Nuke Survival Toolkit comes with full documentation for every tool in the menus. To bring up the documentation PDF, just click on the documentation info icon at the top of the menu. There's over 280 pages with helpful images, credits, descriptions, and external links to help you better understand each tool. To help in searching for the tool, in the beginning of the document there is an index that is laid out in the exact order that appears in the tool menu. Of course, you can also press the Control or Command F key for the search feature and type in the name of the tool that you're looking for. Alright, so before we start demonstrating tools, let me make it abundantly clear that most of these tools were not created by me. I've just gathered them and curated a list of tools that I feel every compositor should have access to in their toolbox while compositing. Many of the tools have demo videos of their own, which are probably far better than anything I'm going to show here now, and I really encourage that you go to the artist websites or Nukepedia pages, which can be found in the documentation, and give them a read through, give them support, comments, feedback if you like their tools. So my main goal here is to perhaps shed some light on some tools that you may or may not have heard about yet, and briefly demonstrate them and go through why I think that they're great to have with you in your toolbox. These are just a few of the tools in the menu. There's no way to get through them all now, so I'm just going to skip around a bit and try to avoid some of the more obvious tools like iBlur and iTransform that we all probably know and love, and maybe introduce some of the lesser known tools in the toolbox. But trust me, iBlur and iTransform are in there too, so let's get started. The first tool I want to show you is Voronoi Gradient. By default, it makes a few points that are transitioning into each other, but you can actually click it to sample from the input, which means that these points are grabbing from the input color. So you can start adding more points, and I'm pretty sure you can add as many points as you like, and it's going to grab the input color from the position of each point. And so, yeah, you can make a smooth transitional gradient between all the points, and the more points you add, the more detail you have. And so we have now a nice sky ramp without the clouds. And what you could do, for example, with this image is you could pop these clouds out by making a difference mat of the clouds versus a luma key, because the luma key might have the gradient. So if you divide the sky by the gradient you've just made, you can sort of desaturate the image and then make this nice key of the clouds. Another practical example of what you could do with the Voronoi gradient is to make a gradient for a blue screen or green screen. And if you have the right amount of points and it's a smooth enough gradient, like in this shot for instance, you can create a blue screen, and the only difference then would be sort of the reflections on the glass. So it can be a kind of a way to preserve and key some of those reflections or fine details that you might not otherwise be able to get with the IBK color gizmo, because it's sort of keeping the details in the clean plate. So you can see here the difference between the two. Another very similar tool is the Grad Magic tool, and this is just a 4-point gradient that is live sampling from the plate. And once you plug in the input, you can see it's sampling around, and we can use it to cover up that lamp or in picture on the wall. So you have the ability to bake the current frame or bake a frame range, and you can also attach a corner pin and blur the edge there, so it's a nice smooth transition. And if I go ahead and bake the frame range here, oh, I've accidentally grabbed the bottom salmon color there, but that's okay. So you can see it's just fairly quick and easy to use for those times you need to make a quick patch. So let's bring in the Noise Advanced and Cell Noise tools. These are really good tools for like look dev and R&D and concept work, trying to find the look of a shot and explore some features. Now the Cell Noise tool has, it's a blink script tool with a bunch of different types of noise. You can see it has size and Z evolution in all of these. And you can really explore some different type of noise that don't come default in Nuke right away. So it helps you explore different patterns. For example, maybe you can use this whirly to make like a lizard skin or something like that. The Noise Advanced is a more standard noise, so it's using the noise that comes with Nuke. But it's basically used for animating the noise with some easy sliders like speed of Z, so you can make the evolution of the noise. And so we can get some cool patterns right away, really easy sliders here. So you don't have to remember any expressions or anything. And you can also translate pretty much anything like speed of Y and speed of X. So you can have it kind of moving off to the side for you to help with distortions or whatever. And so, yeah, that's basically Noise Advanced. The next tool in the draw menu I'm going to show you is X Tesla, and it's really great for making lightning effects. And it comes pre-animated right out of the box, so you set your in and out point for a little bit of direction, and you can change the amount of branches, the length of the arcs, and a lot of random settings to give it a really unique look, as well as a quality preview, so you can make things go a little faster while you're playing around. And it's got like a glow and color options already there installed. And so there it is animating. You can also change the kind of smoothness of the branches to get a kind of unique look. Another great tool is the Spot Flare. And this is mimicking a light shining into the camera and giving off a flare, which you can kind of animate some shimmering rays coming off of. And it's got really nice glow and really natural looking fall off. The next tool we have is Gradient Editor, and it allows you to create a ramp with a lot of different custom colors that you can add and replace, and it's very easy to manipulate. Each point has saturation and hue and luminance controls. You can control the repetition of the pattern within the 0 to 1 ramp, as well as the evolution within the 0 to 1 ramp, so you can kind of make it spinning. You can change the smoothness between the points and the interpolation. It comes with a lot of presets, which you can select and even save your own. You can plug in an input image and actually use the 0 to 1 luminance of the input as a kind of way to tone map your image with your own custom ramp. Another tool in the draw menu is Silk, which takes an input image, in this case a roto paint node with a bunch of lines drawn, and it develops these patterns and kind of moiré effects between them, which you can change the number of streaks and size and softness and color. You can go through the different algorithms that are preset, and it kind of develops all these different abstract patterns, so you can kind of go through them and find the one that you like. You can change the colors, and it's kind of got this color ramp going on in it. It also respects like a moving input, so you can plug in, for example, a caustic-like noise, and you can see that it's going to be moving along with the noise pattern. You can plug Silk into basically any image and create these really cool abstract images that could help you with your concept or whatever look that you're after. Another tool in the draw menu is Perspective Guide, which can give you a visualization of the perspective lines for your image. You can set the origin or the horizon line point there and start moving the other points around to line up the perspective. You can also duplicate the node and get a two-point perspective by placing another point on the horizon line, and that'll help you with some DMP work or lining things up to the plate. Another great tool for regraining your plate is DOS Grain. And in order for DOS Grain to work properly, you'll need your original plate as well as a degrained version of your plate. And when you click the Analyze button, it actually generates a response curve that tells DOS Grain how strongly to apply the grain depending on the luminance of the comp input. And we can be a little bit clever about how to regrain our plate by using a difference mat between the comp and the degrained plate to tell us where to regrain. And so anywhere that's in black is going to be using the original plate grain, and anything in white is going to be using the replaced DOS Grain. And we can use the scatter feature in DOS Grain to take the plate grain in this small area and scatter it everywhere, so we have this random pattern of original grain. And that's what's actually so effective about DOS Grain, is it's actually generating new grain for you based off the grain that you've sampled, so it's going to match very closely with your original. Let's say we have some footage here of these scientists in the room, and we want to offset the timing of the scientist in the foreground. Let's grab the time machine node in the time menu, and if we make a mask between the two men, like so, anything that's in the black is going to be the original timing, and anything in the white is going to be time offset by this frames value that we have. And in the middle, where the transition is going to gradually transition from kind of one time offset extreme all the way to the original plate. And so here you can see we kind of did a split comp, but it's actually a really smooth transition. You see there? Now there he's looking up at the beginning of the shot. But the transition point is actually really smooth in Time Machine. That's why I like it so much. And so here we have some footage of just some smoke clouds that are kind of billowing and deforming there. And if we make a really smooth gradual ramp between one side of the image and the other, and we set the Time Machine to be average and set it to quite extreme, 100 frames off, you see here what it's kind of doing. And the transition point is really well hidden. And so I like to use this node sometimes for controlling effects like smoke or explosions or billows and stuff, because you can see here, comparing the original with the time offset one, it's quite a smooth transition, and it is different, and you can't tell where the seam is. In the channels menu, we have channel control, which is basically a weight between each channels with a slider. So you have sliders for red, green, blue, and alpha, and it allows you to turn the channels on and off, which is good for selecting roto shapes, for example. You can also change operation between the channels. This node can also be used with an input image to pull a different key by sliding the channels around and kind of adding and subtracting different ones to get the value you're looking for. One of the most powerful features in Nuke is the ability to make channels and layers that we can make upstream and be able to pull those channels out later on. So here we have a picture of a boat that's going through some complex motion blur and projection setup. So let's say we have this boat and we want to create some individual matte channels for these windows and these lifesavers. So we can grab the inject matte channel node. And what this node is going to do is it's going to allow us to create a custom name channel very easily. So if we enter a custom name like bottom windows and then click inject new channel, what it's doing is creating a new channel called bottomwindows.red, and it's going to turn red for us and allow us to visually see that it's created a new channel. So if we do the same and we create upper windows and then another one called lifesavers, now we've injected three channels into the stream, and you can see that there are in fact in the viewer there bottom windows, upper windows, and lifesavers. If we pull out a shuffle node, you'll see that we can shuffle them and that we indeed have them inside the stream. Now we can look at the bottom of the transformations and we can pull out each channel, and they will have also gone through the same transformations. Well, so that allows us to, for example, make DI mats or bring the channels with us so that we can use them in the future if we need to. Here are the matte channels extracted after the transformation and just overlaid with the boat to see that they are moving together. One last note about the inject matte channel node is that it works alongside Adrian Pueyo's stamps plugin. So if you have stamps installed, you can connect the stamp to the matte input of the node, and when you click grab title, it's going to intelligently grab the title from the stamp. So that'll allow you to speed up your workflow even faster if you're already working with stamps. Let's take a look at some of the color tools that are inside the Nuke Survival Toolkit. So let's say we want to sample this hectic plate here. If you go to the color menu and go to AP Color Sampler, this is using Blink Script to grab the average color of the entire footage. And it's really, really fast. So let's say we don't want to grab the average color of the whole footage, but instead we want to grab just a small area. So there is an area input, which you can plug a roto shape or any black and white mat into. And it even takes into consideration the feather of the mat or the gray value pixels. So the whiter the image, the stronger the influence is going to be. And you can see the color changing as we adjust the feather of that mat. So once you're happy with the color, you can actually bake it out. So if you click bake, it's going to run a curve tool and run through the timeline and bake the color. Once it's done baking, you can click the create button, which will create a grade node with the color in the animation of the offset. From there, we can drag the offset over to just a constant color, and now we have a constant that is flickering the same as our color sampler. The Blacks Match tool is an image-based toe operation with adjustable falloff sliders. By default, you can choose a single color, or you can plug in the black color input to use multiple colors for your blacks match. So it's actually doing a toe operation based off the input color. I use this tool along with a depth pass when I'm grading CG and also when I'm applying volumetrics. Sometimes we need to apply a shadow from CG onto a live action plate, and we're rendered this colorful shadow matte pass. This is from an Arnold render. And this is supposed to be used to apply the shadow onto a plate and keep the color information. So you can use this shadow mult tool and plug in the shadow matte into the shadow matte input, and it will actually retain the color that is meant to be with the shadow. It's actually using each channel from the shadow matte as a mask to multiply that same channel. So the red channel in the shadow matte is multiplying the red channel of the image. And so you can see it's retaining the color information that way. And it comes with a few sliders for multiply and gamma just to help you apply the shadow a little bit differently, as well as a mix. There are many times where our highlights are too bright and we need to softly roll them off and bring back some detail. So you can use highlight suppress to do a sort of normalize or tone map onto the highlights. And there's a slider called limit affected area, which will help you maintain your midtones and only affect the highlights. The higher the white point slider, the more it will try to suppress the highlights. And when it's down to one, it will be just the input image. There are also some cases where our highlights are just way too bright and they're out of range. And so we need to bring those values back down within an acceptable range, but without destroying the look of the shot. And so we kind of want it to look exactly the same while still achieving the goal of bringing those values down. And so you can use the white soft clip tool and set your maximum value so nothing will go above that value. And it should actually look pretty much the same as the original. But if you gain down the shot, you can see that it's clamping the values at a lower range than the original is. There's some controls for fall off to make it a little bit more aesthetic to how it's soft clipping. But overall, it should look pretty much the same. One sort of simple tool that I use all the time is called bias saturation. And this will sort of desaturate your image towards a specific color. And by default, it doesn't do it all the way, so it's still maintaining some bit of the saturation from the original image, but you can make it go fully desaturated towards that color, and then mix it into the right amount that you need. A practical example of this might be you have this sunset image, and you need to shift the whole sky towards this orange color and get rid of some of that blue. So you could just sample this orangey sunset color, and now the whole sky is starting to lean more towards that color that you've sampled. And you can see if I sample the extreme saturated orange, then it's going there, and you can kind of control how much of the original you want it to maintain. The last color tool I want to mention is called Color Copy. And here we have a street, and we have a color wheel. And if we use Color Copy, we can take the hue and saturation from image A and apply it to image B. So it's retaining the luminance values from the original image. And you can see we can slide around the how much saturation and how much hue is mixed in. And so we're starting to get some interesting results, for example, in the sky there. So if we take an actual like sunset picture and just kind of blur it, so we're going to retain some of those colors. If we plug it into A now and use a mask, we can see we can get some kind of interesting results, sort of like a sky replacement where it's replacing the colors. Here's a white between the replaced sky colors that's using the hue and saturation from the sunset image and the original. We're going to take a look at a handful of tools from the filter menu. And let's say we want to glow this flame here. I tend to use AP Glow. There's a lot of other really good glow tools like Optical Glow and Glow Exponential out there. But I like the aesthetic look of AP Glow and how it falls off and how easy it is to use. It's got some basic settings for intensity and persistence, which can also be called spread or how it falls off. You can tint the color to something other than what the input color is. If you check on effect only, it's just going to be the effect and not the effect plus the input. The source black, source white, and response section is actually doing a pre-grade on the input before it glows. The node comes with a steps integer knob, which is the amount of blur nodes it's using to do the exponential blur. So you can raise or lower the steps number, and it will change the amount of blurs being used in the effect. And I want to go over the difference between the mask input and the area input. The mask input is telling the glow where to be visible after the glow has already been done on the whole image, whereas the area input is sort of masking before the glow has started, so it's telling it what area of the image should glow. So the area input has much more natural results that you would expect if you said, okay, glow this part of the image. Another quick and handy tool is the directional blur, which does exactly what you would think it would do. It blurs in a direction with a rotation control, and so you have the size of the blur and the rotation, as well as a perpendicular blur, which is just perpendicular to the angle you've set. You can see here it's also trying to keep the bounding box as small as possible while you're doing a large blur and rotating. There are some cases where you have a roto shape that you're cutting a character out in, and it's leaving some unwanted edges. And there's many ways to get rid of these and many tools that help you edge extend or edge warp. Personally, I like to use AP Edge Push. And this tool is creating an edge detect distortion map, which is helping to warp the edges outwards. And by default, it doesn't do too much, so we need to increase the value, which is the power of the warp. And the softness is kind of the blur of the distortion map. The falloff is the gamma of the distortion map. And the max indent is how far inwards it's going to affect our image. By default, it's using the alpha of the input image to detect the edge in order to warp it. But you can also plug in another image in the matte input to use that alpha channel as the edge in which to warp, as you can see here. And if you unplug the matte input, it'll just go back to using the image alpha. You could also use the mask input to limit where the effect is visible. In this situation, we're warping RGBA, which means we're also warping the alpha channel, but we could set it to RGB, and so that way after the pre-mult, it appears that we're warping only within the alpha area, and that'll give us the edge extend look that we're going for while still maintaining the original alpha. One tool I've been playing around with recently is Heatwave, which makes some heat distortion effect, and it works pretty much right out of the box. And as you can see here, it's creating sort of like a hazy heat wave there. It also works if you plug in your own custom image in the custom input there. And so you can see the flames are now driving the heat wave, and it looks really awesome. And it's got settings for a global amount and frequency and animation of the heat wave and all sorts of stuff. So I suggest giving it a play. One tool that I'd like to go over that you probably heard of is called AP Chroma. And I think it's very powerful and has a lot of potential. You can use the transform knobs at the top of the node or plug in your own ST map that's been manipulated to drive the chromatic aberration. In this case, we're just going to rotate and scale a little bit to get some kind of spiral effect. And if we turn the smoothness to 1, it's going to kind of interpolate smoothly in between and sample it a little bit more. We can also turn this monochrome feature up to limit the amount of aberration that it's having. But we'll reset those settings at the top for now and click create UV map, which is going to create a UV map that we can start manipulating. And I'm just going to grab a RotoPaint node and use the smudge brush to smudge the UV map around. And the AP Chroma is going to detect the difference from the smudge, and it's going to chromatically aberrate in the direction of the smudge strokes. You could use this, for example, to do a distortion effect onto the UV map, and then you'll essentially have a chromatically aberrated distortion effect using the AP Chroma. Let's talk about using the AP Chroma with some CG pass when you want to put it over background. So here we have a helicopter, and if we make some chromatic aberration on the helicopter using AP Chroma, if we try to over that image, you can see that the AP Chroma is not applied to the alpha channel. So it's going to be overing with the original alpha channel. And there's a reason for that. It's very difficult to chromatically aberrate an alpha channel because it's just a single channel. So how can you have multiple colors? AP Chroma tackles this by chromatically aberrating the alpha channel and saving the red, green, and blue corresponding alphas into a layer called AP Chroma. Here you can see if I pull out the AP Chroma layer that I have this chromatically aberrated alpha channel. And so AP Chroma actually comes with a suite of other tools that are helping us manage this AP Chroma layer, which is the chromatically aberrated alpha channel, so that we can do things like unpremult, premult, blur, transform, and merge over another image. And so I'm going to select AP Chroma Merge from the tool menu, and I'm going to hook it up to the A input. And this is going to give us the correct result for merging a chromatically aberrated image. The red channel is being overed using the red channel from the AP Chroma layer as an alpha, and the same with green and blue. So there's actually 3 merge operations going on, one for each channel with the corresponding alpha. And I just want to quickly demonstrate this is actually giving a different result than if you were to take the AP Chroma layer and desaturate it and try to use this as an alpha channel. Each channel, red, green, and blue, need its own alpha channel in order to merge properly because they each have their own individual amount of opacity. And so using one desaturated alpha channel overall is not going to give you the same result. And this is what I think makes the AP Chroma suite so powerful, is its management of the channels after they've already been chromatically aberrated. Let me show you one of my go-to tools for despilling, which is AP Despill. And I'm going to show you why it's become my favorite despill node. And the first thing you're going to do is choose your despill color, in this case blue. And we can see already that it's leaning towards this kind of nasty green color. So let's try to alleviate that a little bit. So we can choose our despill math between average, maximum, and minimum, and custom, which is going to be a slider between maximum and minimum, I believe. And we can actually go back to average there, and we can do our despill in log space if that's helpful. In this case, I'm going to leave it off. And the real bread and butter of this despill node comes down to this color space. If I select an item from the second menu here, I can then use the arrow keys up and down to just sort of filter through the menu items in this color space. And you have a variety of different types of color spaces that are kind of cycling through. And each one might look a little bit better or worse than another one. So you're trying to find the one that brings you closest to the color that you're trying to despill towards. And if you go over to the second menu, we can do the same thing. We have another variety of options to choose from. And so with these two variations of color space, we can get a really nice result at the start before we even have to start tweaking. What this color space section is doing a color space change before the despill and then reversing it after the despill, so sort of like a color space sandwich. And while you're cycling through the different color spaces, you're changing the ratio between each channel, which is what is giving it different results. So after we're done with the color space section, we can do some subtle tweaks to the hue offset and the tolerance. Usually you don't need to do too much. In this case, I'm just going to tweak the tolerance a little bit. And after that, you can go towards your respill color. And if it's set to 1, it's bringing the luminance back to the original plate value. But if we set it to 0 or any other color, we can start to shift the final color in a specific direction. In this case, I'm going to make it a little warmer to match this monkey's hair. And you can see we have a much better result matching the hair color than we originally started with. And I just want to give a couple more examples of how close you can get with this color space feature. So let's say we wanted to match this guy's facial color right here. So if we go through again, we check the log space and the different despill math, but the real stuff is in the color space where we go through and you can see we're able to match his skin color with just selecting the correct color space. And once again, we have this girl's hair. And we can, you know, shift around these color spaces, and we can see we find a warmer result that matches her kind of golden hair a little bit better. There's some other features like respill math that help you bring back the respill color in a different way, as well as a mix for the node. And you can actually output the despill mat into the alpha, and the despill mat is just the difference between the final result of the despill and the original plate. The next couple of tools have to do with morphing, and they're some of my favorite tools because they're so much fun to play around with. If you go to the transform menu and you select morph dissolve, this is going to dissolve one image into another one. So if you plug in 0 in 1 and set some keyframes, you can basically morph one input into another input. So here I have John Travolta morphing into Nicolas Cage and vice versa in honor of the movie Face Off. So you have some settings here for vector detail and strength that have to do with the chronos or the eye distort. And both will help you get the edges to kind of morph a little bit better with each other, so you can choose whatever works for you. One of the problems with morph dissolve is that you can't tell it where exactly to morph. It just morphs one whole image into another whole image. So let's say we have this picture of this girl, and then we have another picture of Emma Watson, and we want half the face to be Emma Watson and the other half the face to be the other girl. So we can make a mask with a rotoshape that has 0 and 1 and some gradient in between. And we can use the tool iMorph. And so iMorph is just like Morph Dissolve, but it has a mask input. So anywhere that's 0 is going to be the second girl, and anywhere that is 1 is going to be Emma Watson. And so we can do a little animation here and just animate this rotor shape, and we can kind of make this morph go across the face so she's transitioning from one girl to the other girl. This node can be really heavy at times and also a little bit confusing to understand, but just think about like an eye blur or an eye transform. It's just morphing one to the other where the mask input is. And this tool can definitely be one of the more powerful and fun tools in your toolbox if you can get it to work properly. That's all the time that we have now in this webinar. There's plenty more tools that I could go over, but I tried to show as many as I could and give some practical examples. I hope you guys learned something or discovered some new tools that you're excited to try. And go ahead and give the Nuke Survival Toolkit a download and install it in your computer and see how you like it. Once again, thank you to all the people who contributed the tools from Nukepedia and all over the internet. I'm Tony Lyons, and thank you for watching.
Great. So thanks very much there, Tony.
Yeah, you're welcome. Pleasure.
Okay, so we do have a couple of questions that have come in. If you guys have any more questions that you've thought of just while you were watching that video and you want to get them in, now's a good time. But I guess I'm going to cheat. I'm going to use one of my questions. So obviously, that's a great whole selection of tools, and there's obviously quite a lot in there. What was it that sort of prompted you to put all of this together in such an easy to use package?
Yeah, I think like most compositors, we kind of have a collection of our own tools that we have, and I've always been quite organized and like the structure of Nukepedia or how Nuke laid it out. And I think at a certain point, it just got a little bit messy. And I tried to consolidate it and really tried to keep the ones that you could, you know, find online and stuff. And well, yeah, it's just something you can bring along with you. Like I thought, like, oh, if you have to move a studio or something, it'd be cool to just install something really fast and just kind of bring it in, just type in one line of code and bring it with you. And so at a certain point, I realized I needed to document everything for it to be kind of official. And then once the documentation started, it just became its own thing, I think.
Yeah, I mean, it's one thing to put them all together in an easy to use toolbox like you have, but like the documentation that you've supplied along with it is vast, and it goes into some really good depth as to what they are, and not just like listing what you can do with them. I really like the fact that you've kept with all of the, you made sure that you give credit to all of the people that helped build all of these great and interesting tools. And that's something that doesn't get lost, which is really good.
Yeah, I tried my best not to, to give everybody the full credit that they needed and to encourage like people to go in, because everybody has their own demo videos and their own like full write-ups of the tool and stuff. And they're way better than just not knowing what the tool does. And I think that scares people to not know where it comes from or not know what it does or anything. So yeah, I tried my best to do that.
That's good. Okay, so thanks for that. Let's go to one of the questions from the audience. So this is one that I actually thought of as well. But what's the sort of plan for keeping up and to up to date and track with all of the gizmos? Because obviously, individual people making them will have their own updates. So how sort of are you going to stay on top of that?
Yeah, it's a good question. I've been trying to keep it up to date as much as I can. So I'm probably going to do an update about once a month and just have another version of the GitHub. And I'll make a link on LinkedIn or the Facebook forums that I posted to before. So just check in with it every once in a while, I'd say. If you're wondering if there's an update, and you'll probably see a new one. You can feel free to message me if you think a tool is out of date. You can go to my website, creativelyons.com, and use the contact form and just put like NST and just send a message to me or write me on LinkedIn or Facebook or something if you see the Nuke Survival Toolkit forum there.
Yeah, no, that sounds great, because obviously, yeah, that's going to be, there's so much stuff in there. You're going to have a lot to keep track of there, which is
for sure. Yeah, I would like it to be sort of a community thing at some point, but obviously it's going to take a while to get there. But since it is on GitHub, it is sort of an open source thing, so I could see a lot of people like making commits to it, and you could also put like an issues thing in there, and like we could sort of make a community thing out of it. So in the future, maybe it'll be something more like that, but right now I think I'll just keep it as up to date as I can.
Yeah, so obviously we just covered about keeping the ones that are currently there up to date, but are people able to message you and basically suggest new tools and offer new tools?
Yeah, for sure. It's pretty much the same thing. Like if you see a tool that that you like and you think that it belongs there, you can give me a message in the same like creativelyons @gmail.com, and just write to me. And I will, I guess, kind of cater it to, you know, seeing if there's another tool that does kind of the same thing. Or I think it has to be kind of a curated list, and I'm not trying to play like gatekeeper or anything, but it needs to be like I think most cases it'll be fine to like add it, but I don't want it to be too big. The point of it is that like it's a bunch of useful tools, and yeah, I'd like to encourage people to duplicate or clone the repository, and if they really want to go off and make their own, they have, you know, full ability to do that, I think. So
you can basically use this as the starting point for their own personal toolkit, and then they can build their own things as they want to.
That's what I would think. Maybe it's a little bit difficult to do now. I might try to make some tutorials on how to do that, just like clone it over and like how to set up the menus and stuff. But it's actually pretty easy. And so if somebody wants to just take this as like a base and just kind of add their own and delete some of them that they don't want and stuff, they're free to do that. Yeah.
So are you actively looking for people to help out with the sort of curation and the running side of things? Or
I've got some people that are also the collaborators of the GitHub at the moment. I think right now it's mostly just me going through it, but I'm trying to set it up so that there's kind of these rules and stuff that, like, you know, has to be documented, has to be like a public tool, has to be just basic sort of stuff. But I think once we can start getting the community involved, it should be pretty interesting. Yeah, it should be pretty cool.
Yeah, no, I think so. It's very good. It's very, very professional looking and polished. I personally, once I saw it, it was like, wow, this really is a whole lot of good stuff in there.
Thanks.
Okay, so I've got another question here. So all the gizmos created, are all the gizmos created as groups so that anyone, even those without the toolkit, can open the Nuke file and use them?
Yeah, they are. They come into Nuke as groups. They're gizmos on the file. So when you bring them in, Nuke thinks they're a gizmo, but they actually turn out to be a group. So I think a lot of people know this thing, but there's a few benefits, like the properties panels opens automatically, and it saves your defaults in that session of Nuke. So you're kind of like tricking Nuke a little bit. So there's kind of like these benefits to doing it that way. But yes, they are groups. Nobody needs to have it installed. Like if you start using them, nobody needs to have it installed to render on the farm or to open it up if they don't have it. And they're also all custom named with NST underscore the tool name. So you'll never have conflicting gizmos. So if somebody has iBlur, this will be NST iBlur. So it won't conflict if you already have a tool in there.
It keeps them separate for the stuff that you've already previously got. Okay, I see.
Yeah.
Cool. Just going through some more of the questions here. I guess since we were talking about updating and how we're going to do that, there's a question here, which is on the update line, what's the plan for Nuke compatibility? You have some tools that are Python based, which might be complicated to keep 100%, especially when we're moving over to Python 3. Will there be different lines in terms of your Git splitting or something like that?
Yeah, that's a good question. Maybe I could start writing some Nuke 11, Nuke 12, like different, like it loses a different gizmo depending on the group. But I haven't come up across, there's a few tools in there that I think it was PyQt or something that didn't work, like Gradient Editor on Nuke 12, I believe. Mm-hmm. I don't know if Mads Hagbarth has an update for that, but I'll keep a lookout. I'm not too savvy with some of that stuff yet, but I'll definitely try to keep it working with at least the latest version of Nuke and a little bit backwards compatible, like Nuke 11, Nuke 12.
Sure. No, that sounds good. Let's go down. Have you seen any questions in there that you particularly like? Sorry, not to put you on the spot there.
No, that's right. Take a look.
I suppose I can, while you have a quick look, I can answer this. It just disappeared from me. There you go. Will it work on Nuke Indie? Yes. I mean, I've personally installed the toolkit and it does work. But obviously, depending on which tools you're using and what's actually happening behind the scenes with that tool, it might hit some of the limitations that are in Nuke Indie, such as the Python being the Python restriction being one of them. But the large majority of the purely gizmo-based nodes all work exactly as you'd expect out of the box. So, yeah.
Mm-hmm. I'd like to add to that. It does, a lot of the tools do use Blink Script, and that can throw some people off sometimes. So naturally, any version of Nuke that doesn't support Blink, those tools will not work on those versions. But they'll work on a regular Nuke license, I think.
Good. I'm just going through. Look, there's a lot of questions there. I personally was thinking, like, with all of these tools that we do have here, and obviously you probably use them, I mean, you definitely use them quite a lot within your own workflows and your scripts in general. How much time do you think in general you've saved by having all of these great tools at your disposal, as opposed to having to build everything again from scratch when you're trying to do these things?
It's a really good question. I mean, I would say it's kind of invaluable. Because you know, if you need to do something more than once, you kind of just you build it once, and then like 4 months later, you'll think of something. You'll, oh, that was that one tool. Like I remember we created that that iMorph tool for like some specific thing at the company that I was at, and we just kind of have it in there, and it's super cool. And you know, how often do you use it? I don't know, but to try to remember how you made it before and to like make it again. It'd be kind of difficult, I'd say. So it saves a lot of time just by having something. You're like, oh, there was that one tool I remember at some point, and then you just jump into it. You can browse through it, and you're like, I thought there it is. And so I thought that was kind of interesting because you always forget like which one. Then it saves you the time of having to look on Nukepedia. Oh, like where is it on Nukepedia? I don't remember the name of it. Yeah.
Yeah. No. Definitely. This is an interesting one. How well do the tools handle overscan in general?
You mean like the bounding box, like overscan the bounding box, I think.
Right? I think that's what he's referring to.
Very good question. I've tried to adjust as many tools as I could to work really intelligently with bounding box, like some of the glow tools and stuff. They have a smart like bounding box cap and stuff. And a lot of them, that's something I pay attention to quite closely and something I've had to make changes of with some of the tools. So they're not exactly... Some of them aren't exactly like from Nukepedia. They're like little changes, like adding a mix and keeping the bounding box not exploding into a million. So yeah, that is something I pay attention to quite a lot.
No, that's good. I got one here from our very own Pete Coleman in the support team. So is there an emailing list or anything to be able to sign up to get the updates? So you get a notification when there is an update to the list.
That's a good question. No, not at the moment. I would really like to do that. There is, I've been posting to the Facebook user groups, but I know that not everybody uses that. So between that and LinkedIn, I mean, yeah, I could probably set up an email list or something. Maybe I'll reach out to Josh Parks so he can help me set that up or something.
Okay, let me have...
Just on that note, every time I do a version, a release, I do have a document called like release notes, and that is everything. It's like a record of what I've changed from one version to the next. So I've done this thing called new tools highlights. So that's just the new tools that I've added, from the documentation, and those also just go into the documentation later. But to save people having to look through what was different about the documentation. I don't know, because it's huge, it's like 300 pages. So that's kind of a way. So if I get this email list, that's a really good idea. I'll try doing something like that.
Yeah, so just as an interesting thing for me, what was it, which took the longest time? Was it building the toolkit together in a way so that it worked, or was it making that documentation?
The documentation, without a doubt. I was sitting there for like months just writing that documentation, like, when is this, just 2 hours a night, just when is this going to be done? But yeah, it's important, it's important. And it helped me cater the list a bit more. Like sometimes you have these duplicate tools you don't even know about that are like doing pretty much the same thing that you're like, oh, this one does it a little bit better. Or you have a tool in there maybe that you couldn't find online again. You're like, oh, I'm not sure where this came from. Like somebody gave it to me at one point or something. So it helped to bring the list down to like an acceptable level of tools. And so I can really say that I went through like every tool and like they serve a purpose and like they do something unique or something like that. So it was helpful in that way, but it was kind of a pain in the ass. Yeah.
Okay. No, it's just like that was the main thing. Like it was just so well done. Cause like I've gone around and gathered up a load of my tools previously, going to Wikipedia, finding them on the web. Some of them I barely touched because I've never known exactly what they were doing or why I would want to use them. I just know it's there, it's a thing, I'll go grab it. And then having that really has shed a light on a lot of the ones that I previously had.
Yeah, that's the thing, is like you find something cool and you kind of add it, but you kind of lose track of what you already have. And so this was a nice way for myself, just to kind of like, okay, what do I have in here? Like, let's bring it down to like a a good level there. So,
okay, let's try this one. So you've talked about using the morph tools to blend paint patches in and out. Could you talk a little bit more about your approach on that workflow? It feels weird to use a morph to dissolve to blend the whole image just to fade in a small patch. Would you use a mask with iMorph then?
Right, it's a really good question. I thought about using it in the demo video there, but basically with a paint patch, and let's say you have a paint patch of a wall and somebody is walking in front of it for like a few frames. What you want to do normally is to pick an in frame and an out frame. So when something is crossing over something, you start with a frame that's a real frame and you end with a frame that's a real frame. So then what you need to do is track the two frames. So the beginning frame is tracked to the end and the end frame is tracked to the beginning. So you have these two moving paint patches, one for the end, one for the beginning. And then to get rid of any, like if you just dissolve it, there might be some discrepancy in some lighting or something like that. But if you use a normal dissolve, you get some doubling. But if you morph as it's moving and they're both moving in the same way, then they'll just dissolve, they'll morph dissolve together. And since you end on a frame that you can turn off and you begin in a frame that you can turn on, it like it's magic, kind of just like, oh, you can really trick people because they can't see the patch turning on and off. And all they could really see is if you are morphing it and then dissolving it. And so if it does go kind of haywire, you can always just add another keyframe. And so it's kind of morphing from one keyframe into another keyframe. And it works really well with smart vectors and stuff. So it's like one of the things I do all the time, like just morphing smart vectors together. And you can get some crazy, crazy cool results.
Yeah. No, I playing around with smart vectors is really there's so much you can do and so much that you don't know you can do with them. They're right. A really good way of getting access and doing a lot of things that you wouldn't necessarily expect with them.
Mm-hmm. For sure.
Let's try this one. So is it possible to make a template folder to save things that you have done and worked really well? Saves going back to old comps and opening them. I'm not entirely sure I understand what that question is after reading it a second time there. But what I think what I thought it was is more sort of like, is there a way, like with all of those tools that you've got there, is there a way to mark the tools that you know specifically that you like and have them like almost like a favorites list within the toolkit to highlight the ones that you like, basically?
That's a good question. I'm not sure. I mean, does Nuke has that favorites kind of search feature? I mean, I'm assuming if you use the tool enough, because it's part, I think it'll be listed as like part, a tool that's in your system, because it's in the tab system. That's another benefit of having it as a gizmo instead of a group, because if it's a group, it's a little bit harder to do that. So because it's part of the system, I imagine that it would be favorited if you use it a bunch, I think.
If you use it enough, it's got a weighting system there, so right. it will naturally come to the top as you go through. Sorry, just one second. I mean, of all of those, I know this is going to be a very hard question to answer, but of all of those tools that you've got there, do you have a favorite one or one that you most commonly either use, or like, I don't know how you want to justify that one. It's either the one that you most commonly use or the one that you find the most fun to use, I guess.
Yeah, that morph dissolve one is pretty cool. And I think I tend to like like a group of tools that are made by artists. I think that's that. If you notice the list, there's a lot of repeating artists and characters. Like anything that's made by Mads Hagbarth, I love. Mark Joey Tang, Adrian Pueyo. I mean, I just there's some artists I feel like they've just gained my full trust, and like anything they make is just gold. And I'm like, oh, let's play with this new Mads Hagbarth tool and stuff. So I think that's probably my best answer there. It's just like. And I'm always excited to see a tool from these creators, and I'm like, it's just put it in. I saw somebody mention, I forgot to mention that you can click the watch button on my GitHub, and that would notify you if there was an update or a new release. So that was a good Hans mentioned that. So thank you for that.
I So I guess I can go. Will it install with Nuke NC? Yes, it will install with Nuke NC. But as I mentioned previously with the question about Nuke Indie, depending on which tools you use, there will be limitations that you will hit. So yes, you can use it with non-commercial. I think we're rounding up all of the questions there. So I think if that is it, we'll get another minute or so to quickly add some more. But so do you think there's obviously when you put this all together, do you think was there a bit of a learning curve to, I don't know how Pythonically savvy are you? And
not much.
was an interesting journey.
It was a learning curve of like, I remember one of the reasons I set up the menu was I saw my friend make his own menu with icons and stuff. And I was like, oh, that looks really cool. And because I just always had mine in the Nuke, what is it called? The toolbar? Tool sets? Yeah, the tool sets. Sorry.
Oh, no, you mean tool, I guess. Sorry, yeah.
So I always use it in tool sets. And but that has a downfall. If it doesn't have icons, it doesn't come in as a gizmo and stuff. And so I ended up making one for my own tools. And that was kind of easy enough. And then I was like, oh, if I'm going to do it for my own tools, I might as well just make it for all like the giant list of tools that I had in a nice organized kind of way. And as I was doing that, I must have learned so much. Like I learned these weird kind of things that Nuke likes and doesn't like. Like it doesn't like when two things are named the same and it kind of collides, kind of doesn't like that. So I was okay, that's something I didn't know before.
Nuke can be very picky.
it was a new side of Nuke that I hadn't seen before. Also using GitHub, I wasn't too. I've used it for myself, but using it as a community thing, I'm still pretty new to it. So apologies, everybody that is a GitHub wizard. I'm not quite there yet, but I'm getting there. It's on its way. But certainly, there's a lot of things that I learned in this way.
Let's try this one. Do you see limitations for the creation of vanilla scripts, i.e., for stereo to vendor packaging? So I think that's asking about basically if you're using these tools in the creation of your scripts and you need to package it up for somebody else to pick up. How easy is that to do? I mean, we've kind of covered that a little bit with the whole are they groups question there. But how difficult? What would you have to go out of the way in some way to do that?
No, not at all. Because they're groups, anybody can open the scripts and they're saved in the script themselves. So they're very standalone. So it's not going to conflict with anything. So you should be fine with that.
Great. I think that is rounding out all of our questions today, Tony. Okay. So I think we'll call that a day today. Okay. So that's it from us. Thank you very much, Tony, for joining us. And
Thanks for having me.
Yeah, thank you all of you who've been here adding questions and asking Tony for things. I hope this session was insightful. I know it was for me. I found out lots of new interesting tools that I can go and have a play with now. If you have any other questions for us or Tony, I suppose, if you please don't hesitate to send us an email and reach out to us. And I guess just stay safe wherever you are in the world. And I hope to see you here again soon.